Open all the programs. There is one small error in program lab 3.4. Add one line into the program. In this lab 3.4, line number 300. Go to line number 300. There is one RMS error which is written here, which is blinking right now. Delete that and write this word. Write this word here. Instead of RMS error, RMS, delete RMS error. And write unsteadiness. Note that this is lab 3_4 2D advection.sci. Line number 300. At the last moment, we were doing some correction, so by mistake, it is. This needs to be deleted. So I will, let me write down what I want. It needs to be. Okay. Just type this. Yeah. Unsteadiness is equals to 1e^6. Otherwise, when you run the code, you may get some error. You have to type this. So either you delete this RMS error or you type this. I'll repeat it again later on. Let us open the lab sheets. Open the lab sheet. All of you, please open the lab sheet. Let us do the following. First, I'll explain the lab problems. Then you can start working. Pay attention and understand, because many times you asking questions without listening what is said here. The initial part, this is same what I had discussed in the last lab session, that you have here problem as well as answer sheet, and there is an instruction how to save the figure. By this time, you already know that how to do it. Then the first problem is on computational heat conduction, and in this problem, you are note that all the code which we are giving you is two-dimensional unsteady state code in Cartesian coordinate system. You are solving some problem, but you can modify the boundary conditions and you can solve some other problem, but only you can solve two-dimensional Cartesian coordinates system problem. So then don't think that this is a software by which you can solve any CFD problem. Okay, but I think for a first course in CFD, this is good enough. For a beginner, this is good enough. At least you get a confidence that how softwares are built up. So this is the first step in this direction, that direction. How, okay, so let us first start with, basically this lab session, there are, yesterday evening, we had lecture on computational heat conduction, correct? After yesterday lab session on grid generation, the first lecture in the evening was computational heat conduction, where I had shown you solution for two class of problems. One, all Dirichlet boundary condition, which is shown as case A here, with volumetric heat generation 0. And in here we have made another case C, where you have some non-zero volumetric heat flux. This I had not done in my lecture, but this is additional thing. But basically there are two types of boundary condition, one all Dirichlet and second, left wall 100, bottom wall insulated, right wall constant heat flux, and top wall convective boundary condition. Two standard boundary condition with volumetric heat generation, without volumetric generation. Four cases you have to simulate, and which program you have to use, note that, because sometimes you start running the wrong program and then you ask it's this program you have to run. It's the first problem, so the name is 3_1. Here you have to plot temperature for the four different cases A, B, C, D. You have to prepare a table for heat transfer. I had written what we mean by the positive values and the negative value from the different walls, left wall, right wall, bottom wall, top wall. There is a total heat transfer. So you have to make, when you run the code displays that on the different wall, what is the heat transfer. You have to just type that in a table. You also type the volumetric heat generation, total heat gain, total heat loss. So So you get an idea about the energy balance. I will show you what is the solution, and you have to discuss the effect of volumetric heat generation on the results. I will show you the solution so you get a feel what I am saying. This is the solution. Four figures for four different cases. Isotherms. Okay. Note that this four cases, you have to run the program four times, and boundary condition in this code is given as switches. Okay, let me first show the result, then I'll show you the code also, so that today I want to give a feel of the code also. So what is A? A is the temperature contour for case A. For case B, this is the temperature contour for case B. This is for case C, and this is for case D. So by just looking into the figure, you can understand case C and D are what? With volumetric heat generation. A and B is what? Without volumetric heat generation. So just see what is the difference of the volumetric generation in the two figures. I will not say more. You have to discuss about it. Where you will discuss? After this, there is a table for, we have already drawn a table and we have put some blank spaces. You just have to type the values here. Okay, so the answer sheet format is completely ready. You have to only paste the figure or write at some space. Caption, table caption, figure caption, those are already provided to you. Finally, you have to discuss the effect limited in this text box only. Then we have for multi-solid heat conduction. For multi-solid heat conduction, you have to solve the multi-solid heat conduction, I think only for two cases. Which are those two cases? Case A and B, which is volumetric heat generation. Okay, so in this case also, you have to draw the temperature contours like this. Again, you have to prepare table as in the first problem. Okay. So these are the two things which you do for second problem. For nonlinear heat conduction, the problem states that this is the same problem which here you will get K naught, and you have to run the program for three different values of B. This is the values of B I had shown in the lecture slide. B is equals to 0, B is equals to 1, and B is equals to minus 0.01. You have to enter K naught, rho, Cp. Note that in earlier problem also, you have to enter this thermophysical property. Because when you run the code, it will ask what is the density, what is the specific heat, thermal conductivity. So make sure that you enter these numbers properly. For this multi-solid, you don't have to enter the property because there are four material, you will take a lot of time in entering the values. So all these properties, we have hard-coded in the code. But in the first problem, you have to enter the properties. For nonlinear conduction also, you have to enter this property values. You have to run this program. Note for each problem there is a particular program. Okay, so run this problem 3_3 nonlinear conduction, and you have to, in this case, you have to run the code for three different values of B, and then plot temperature as a function of X. So you'll get three figures. And you have to discuss the nature of variation for positive and negative values of B using Fourier law of heat conduction. Okay, and I'll show you the result, how it should look like finally. So these are the three temperature profile. This is for B is equals to 0, read the caption. And the second is at B is equals to 1, and this is at B is equals to minus 0.01. And then you have to discuss the result here. On the fourth problem, so this completes the conduction. Conduction, we have three problem: single solid conduction, multi-solid conduction, non-linear conduction. And here what we are showing is a steady state solution. In the fourth problem, it's computational heat advection, where you have left wall non-dimensional temperature 1, bottom wall 0. This problem which I had shown earlier, and these are the different advection schemes. This is, I'll show you the caption. First order upwind scheme, second order quick scheme, temperature contour, and the velocity profile along vertical center line. All these are, first column is temperature contour, second column is variation of temperature and the vertical center line. First row is first order upwind, second order upwind, And the last row is quick scheme. Here you have to discuss the results also. So there is a text box for that. The last problem is convection, slug flow. Okay. Last problem is slug flow in a plain channel. Length of the channel is 6, height is 1 unit, velocity is u is equals to 1, v is equals to 0. The initial condition is 0 in this case. Okay, in maybe in one or two problem you may have to enter initial condition. Let us say I think in advection, what is the boundary value? 0 and 1. So you can enter any initial condition, you should get same result, but the computational time may vary based on your initial condition. If your boundary values are 0 and 1, good initial condition is 0.5. So for the slug flow, you have to plot the steady state temperature contours for the different advection scheme. And then finally, you have to plot the temperature profiles which are used for benchmarking. So the data for benchmarking which is obtained from the analytical solution is already hard coded in the code. So this is the study. So here again, you have two columns. First column represents the temperature control, second column represents the temperature profile at different actual location. And first row corresponds to, this is first order upwind scheme, this is quick scheme. This you have to do at Reynolds number of 10, and here you have to discuss this result. Okay, now before you start doing it, let me show you the code, because yesterday some of you have suggested that if I can take the code line by line and try to explain you what is there in the code. So just to show you that this code is indeed implemented whatever I taught in the lecture slides. So what is there in this code? Let us try to understand. I had given you pseudo code, but here you have to use certain syntax. Syntax may vary. So here there is a command display. Display command means that whatever you write here within code, this will be displayed when you run the program. So what will be displayed? Enter the following data for the conducting medium. Then density will come. So you have to enter the value of density. Then you will ask for specific heat, thermal conductivity, and then this is a thermophysical property entry. Now there will be second entry. What will be the second entry? Enter the geometrical details for the domain, length of the domain in the two direction. Then there will be third entry. Enter the grid details. Maximum number of grid point in x and y direction. Then this is a command to calculate the delta x and delta y value. Okay, what is the expression? Delta x is equal to length in the x direction divided by I max minus 2. Because if there were 7 grid points, there were 5 division. Then this is volume, delta x into delta y. This is the equation used to calculate the stability criteria. 0.5 delta x square delta y square divided by k by rho. In fact, in case the diffusion coefficient is alpha k by rho cp. This is basically that stability criteria which is shown in the slide. And this is the initialization of that temperature. As I said that when you run a transient code, at each time step you need two temperature values. One is the old and another is the new value. So this T is the new and T old is the old. So this is the initialization of both the matrices. This is the initialization of, as I said that in this code, for an easy understanding on the code development, we are also creating matrices for QX and QY. Note that the size of the matrix for temperature and QX and QY are different. Because if you remember, there were 7x7 circles in my implementation detail. And the green squares were 6 in the X direction, 5 in the Y direction. Inverted triangles were 5 in the X direction, 6 in the Y direction. So the size of the matrix were different. So that's why they are different here. Then I think this is used later on for plotting, because finally when you plot, you need transpose of the temperature. Is this correct? So this is to convert the final temperature value which you get to convert into a transpose form. This XP is the coordinate of the vertices or cell center? Extreme vertices. Okay. So basically this is a, you can say, the part of the grid generation. So here the X coordinate and Y coordinate of the vertices are calculated, and this is the initial condition. Like if you have left 100, bottom 200, right 300, top 400, then you have to put initial condition. The best initial condition in this case is 100 plus 200 plus 300 plus 400 divided by 4, which is 250 degrees centigrade. You will be asked enter the initial condition. But whether you had enter initial condition as 250 or 100 or 400 or 1000, steady state temperature will not change, note that. only the animation which you will create will change, because the transient will vary, but the steady state solution will be same. Note that steady state solution is independent of initial condition in CFD. However, the transient varies from the initial condition. This is a now boundary condition is starting. Okay, so we started with thermophysical property, then when we enter into user has to enter the grid size, then the geometric the x coordinate and y coordinate of the vertices were completed, the initial condition got, then the next is the boundary condition. Here for each boundary we have put switches. What are this? These are switches. First switch for constant wall temperature, second for insulated or symmetry, third for convective wall heat, convective heat transfer, fourth for constant heat flux. So for each wall it asks you that whether what you is your boundary condition. So you have to have four switches, 1, 2, 3, 4. So whatever you pick, it takes the value appropriately. If you enter first switch, then it will ask you what is the temperature. If you act second switch, it's an insulated, so it will not ask you anything, because when it's insulated you don't have to enter anything. If it's a constant heat flux, it will ask you what is the heat flux value. If it's a convective heat transfer, then it will ask you two things: what is h, what is T infinity. Okay, for each wall this switches have been incorporated. So all these are boundary conditions along with switches. So it takes lot of lines in the code. This is the function to calculate the RMS to check for steady state condition. Actually, to make the language simple, what I had done is that although we are calculating RMS error, but for ease in understanding, later on what I am doing is that I am defining a term and unsteadiness. Okay, and literally what we mean is that rather than saying RMS error less than, let us say, zero, practically zero based on your convergence criteria, I had defined a literal term which I called as unsteadiness. Later on that I equate that unsteadiness to the RMS error. Okay, so this is a while loop to check whether this unsteadiness, which is basically the RMS error, but before you start this loop, note that you have to initialize it, otherwise it will not go inside this loop. So you initialize it like a very large value, so that even if somebody gives a very large convergence criteria, let us say 10 to power 5 also, then also it will go inside this code. However, we expect that this convergence criteria should be of the order of 10 to power minus 3, minus 4, minus 5 or so on. Before you do the next time step computation, you take the present time value as the old time value. This is the time marching step. This is actually this is the main loop for the explicit method iteration. This is the application of the boundary condition. Okay, now what is this? Can anyone tell me? Note the loop. This is for heat flux in the x direction, qx. You remember the way we had discussed the formulation? First we calculate qx, qy, then do a balance, then calculate the temperature. So this is a loop for that green square. How many green square we have? 6 in the x direction, 5 in the y direction. So that way if you loop into the loop, it is i is 1 to i max minus 1, 7 minus 1 6, 1 to 6, and on the j direction, vertical direction, 2 to 7 minus 1, 2 to 6, which makes it 5. Okay, so this way, and note that there is a something different here. What is this? If I is equals to 1 and I max minus 1, which are border values, the distance between the cell center is one yellow and one blue, and the distance is half of the cell width. Whether you got what I am saying? Near to the boundary. What I am saying is, if I want to calculate heat flux here, the distance between this point and this point is delta x by 2. If I calculate here, this is delta x. Okay, that half cell width will be needed when I calculate qx at the boundary here and here. So here I is 1, here it is I max minus 1. So in the code you can see, if I is equals to 1, this bar is OR, syntax is for OR. OR I is equals to I max minus 1, then in the denominator it is delta x by 2. It is forward difference for the left wall, backward difference for the right wall. This is loop to calculate the heat flux in the y direction. Note here it is 1 to j max minus 1, 1 to 6 and 2 to 6. Once you have calculated qx, qy, what we do? We calculate the total heat gained by conduction here and then the temperature. So you can see this code is exactly what you see in the slides, implementation detail, solution algorithm. Then RMS error is calculated. To give it a more literal meaning, I am calling this RMS error as unsteadiness. Then finally, these are the, here basically I think is taking transpose of the temperature, because when you want to plot it, the plotting software wants the data structure in a particular way. Otherwise what will happen, your bottom wall become top wall or it may become left wall. You want bottom to be bottom in your, when you are looking into the plot. So for that you may have to understand that a plotting software, what is the data structure it wants to plot it appropriately. So in this case he has taken a transpose of it, and then finally he is using this spray plot plot for contour, for plotting the contour of temperature. And then he is doing, all these are called as post-processing. What is the post-processing in this case? Heat loss from the each wall. So basically what he is doing is summing up qx from the bottom wall and top wall to calculate the total heat transfer on the left, right, bottom, top, heat generation if it is there, okay, and then printing it out. So if this print will come to your screen, you just need to note this value in the table. And this is for, you can also do one thing, actually this is, once you have got run into steady state, then this plot is coming. Actually what you can do is that when you are doing a transient simulation, sometimes if you want to create a movie, actually this plot he has put inside the time loop. And what he has done here is, after every 25 time marching, a screen will come. What, when you run the code, it will start time marching. From one time step, two time step, three time step, it will continue the time marching. So let us suppose it takes 1000 time steps, 1000 time marching to reach to the steady state. After every 50, because you may feel bored that you are looking into the screen, it's only showing convergence criteria, it's going from 100, 200, 300. So after 50, it will show you some picture, so you feel, make you happy. Okay, so at least you can see that you are getting some results. Because these computations will take some more time as compared to the grid generation, okay. So you have to be little patient, okay. Any question on this code specifically? Do you think this programming language is difficult? You need to know. Zeros, actually what happens is that if I want to create a matrix of, let us say 10 by 10. And if I want to have all the element as zero, if you would see your Fortran, then you have to write maybe 5-line, 6-line program for loop, and then here you have single line command. So zeros, let us say 10 by 10 creates a matrix of size 10 by 10 with all the element zero. It's like MATLAB. MATLAB also you have commands like zeros, ones, that command. Here actually in this programming, this software, the good thing is that it has lot more inbuilt library functions. Like to take maximum, if you are writing in C and Fortran, you have to write function for that. Here there is an inbuilt library, you just write maximum. So if it is a vector, you write maximum of, let us suppose X is a vector, column vector or row vector. So if you write maximum of X, it will give one value. If it is a two dimensional matrix, you have to use maximum of X to get one. This is the command which you use in MATLAB, and the same commands are work here also. So there is a lot of inbuilt function. The debugging is easy, so that way this code is this, and why we chose this is that this is anyway open source software, and it has inbuilt graphics, it has inbuilt lot of libraries, so that way this is a good one, especially for undergraduate teaching. Although if you want to solve complex CFD problem, as compared to C or Fortran programs, this takes slightly more time, but for a beginner I think this is a very good software. So for a basic CFD course, I think this is a good one to start with. Okay, so how you'll run this program? You know how by this time how to run it. You should run, click execute, and then you get here. I think I had discussed this in earlier also. Let although I had given in my problem some density, some specific heat, but I use some other value also. Steady state result will not vary. So let me put some value because I am not remembering it. So this is the left wall boundary condition. Okay. So let us put it 100. First I will to decide which boundary condition. One means constant wall temperature. Bottom boundary, one means constant wall temperature. Again, right wall, top wall. This is steady state criteria. Let me put it 0.001. This is the way after every 50 iteration temperature is varying. So this is like an animation. This is the convergence which is occurring. It will stop when it reaches 1 into 10 to power minus 4. So this is the steady state temperature distribution. Actually, you may feel that this is not matching with my slide. You are right, because your convergence criteria needs to be much smaller. What I had given in my problem, convergence criteria will be 1e minus 6, correct? I had done what? 1e minus 3. So that's why it has not reached to complete steady state. Okay. Any question before we get started? Note that once you run the program, it gives you heat loss from the left wall, right wall, bottom wall, top wall, heat generation, total heat gain, total heat loss, and energy balance. Any question? Okay, we'll stop here and you can get started with the lab.